Here's where you're going to learn how to play the opening properly. Now, if you master the ideas I'll discuss on this video, you needn't fear anything the opponent can throw at you. And we'll draw up a list of general principles, ideas, which will make your opening play rock solid. Now, there are many, many different chess openings, and it's not for me to tell you which to play or which you shouldn't play. There's enough variety for everyone. But I think we can find some common ground, some ideas which go throughout the entire range of chess openings. And let's get down to the most important idea first, I think. Because of White's first move, his extra move, he's got a slight advantage to begin with. So if you're White, rather like the server in tennis, I'd be expecting you to press, to attack, to utilise, to use your extra move. And similarly, if you're Black, I'd be expecting you to try and neutralise the advantage of White's first move. And there are many, many different ways you can do that, of course. And there are other general principles which can follow on from this. Firstly, you need to learn how to develop your pieces quickly and effectively, to use them as a unit, to work all together. You have to play to control or occupy the centre in the opening. This is very important. The centre of the board is the most important area at the start. If you get a grip on the centre, it's likely you're going to have the advantage. And remember, this idea of getting your pieces working together is the crucial one. The beginner lashes out, maybe moving the queen around or just using one or two pieces, this and that. You need to learn how to use your pieces as a unit. And it's this idea we'll take with us as we go now to look at the games. In this first game, we're going to learn how quick development can be used to advantage. We're going to see why castling early is very important. And we're also going to learn that pawn grabbing, even at grandmaster level, is usually fatal in the opening stage of the game. Get your pieces out. Don't munch material. Well, first up for you, we've got a real cracker of a game between two top grandmasters, Walter Brown from the United States and Miguel Quinteros from Argentina. And it's really remarkable how a game between two grandmasters can highlight some very basic points about how to play the opening correctly. But here we'll see Black breaking all the rules and get punished for it. Now, the opening, as you might expect, between two top players was fairly straightforward. White played 1e4, that's the most aggressive move to start off with because it lets out all the pieces. And Black employs an opening known as the Sicilian Defence. This opening has found favour with many of the world's top players and virtually all the world champions, because it kind of dissuades White from playing d4 early on, which dominates the centre. It's a very good opening and I highly recommend it. White plays knight f3, this is a regular Sicilian move, and Black plays d6, just bolstering up his centre pawn. And now comes bishop to b5 check. This is a very sensible move, rather dull actually, and normally aggressive players prefer the move d4 here, pawn to d4. But bishop b5 check in itself is a very good move. It develops a piece, gives check and threatens Black. So, not so bad after all. Quinteros played bishop d7. And White just exchanged the bishops. Bishop takes d7, queen takes d7. And now comes the first slightly unusual move by White. Pawn to c4. Now, I've actually highlighted what I think White's after in this position. He's trying to get a grip on the square d5. That's a very important central square, which, if White's allowed to dominate it, will stop Black from doing things throughout the entire game. So that's White's aim. The pawns on c4 and e4 control the square d5, and the knight on b1 will come out to c3, again emphasising White's control of d5. And hereabouts, Black has really got to form a plan. How's he going to combat this hold on d5? Well, Black can develop his pieces in many ways here, but what Quinteros does is incredibly risky and cannot really be recommended as good. Queen to g4. Now, admittedly, that move wins a pawn. Probably that's why Quinteros played it. The queen attacks the pawn at g2, and the queen attacks the pawn at e4. But it's a neglection of all basic opening principles, a move like that, because it goes around pawn snatching when really all Black should be thinking about is developing his pieces. Now, after a move like that, usually the simplest solution is the best, and Brown chose a very effective way of meeting Queen G4. He just simply castled, offering Black the chance to take the pawn, and after taking the pawn, he got onto the attack straight away by playing pawn to D4, opening up the position completely. And here's the deal. When you're ahead in development, you open up the game in order to get onto the attack. That's really the basic rule which I want you to take in at this point. And now, with Black falling dangerously behind in development, he's actually got to be very, very, very careful what he does. Otherwise, he could go down straight away to a quick attack. Well, I'm not sure what advice I can offer Black in this position, but Quinteros decided to get rid of White's central pawn. C takes D4. And now came another very good move by White. Not just robotically taking back the pawn on D4, he played Rook E1, again forcing the black queen to move. And Black's queen went back to C6. Now came Knight takes D4, and Black had an opportunity once again to take another white pawn. Well, I don't know what Quinteros was trying to prove in this game, but he took off White's pawn. And this really is gilding the lily in many ways. It's asking for trouble. Personally, I would have retreated the black queen, and in no way would I have taken that pawn, because it just opens up lines for White's pieces. In this sort of situation, the recipe is get your pieces out and attack. And that's precisely what Grandmaster Brown does. Out came the knight with gain of time. The poor old black queen has to move again, and she grovelled back to C8. But what a pathetic position this is for Black after, what, 10 moves. He hasn't developed any pieces at all off the bat rank. Just one pawn has been advanced. Okay, he's two pawns up. But, well, this sort of situation should be avoided at all cost, because White can attack Black so speedily and so effectively with simple moves. Bishop f4. A very strong move indeed. Let's count the developed pieces. White has two knights, a bishop and a rook, all in the game. He's about to play his rook to the c1 square, attacking the black queen. And as you can see, White may also be threatening bishop takes d6 in this position, or knight from a3 into b5 and then knight takes d6, which will be colossally strong. All things being equal, I think Black is probably lost already in this position. And this, a grandmaster after only 11 moves. Quinteros moved his queen again. He played queen d7. And right on time, Brown played knight a to b5. A very, very strong move indeed, threatening to take on d6 with the knight, which will completely destroy Black's position. Quinteros played e5. Now, he desperately would not want to play that move. It's like putting your head into the lion's mouth playing such a move. But he has to defend himself against the threat of knight takes d6. It's not that Black intends to win a piece in this position. Black's not threatening to take anything because the pawn on e5 is pinned. It's just a kind of desperate escape mechanism that Black is trying to adopt here to get out of the unpleasant prospect of a quick white attack against his king. Now, in this type of situation, where you've got all your pieces developed and Black has hardly any pieces developed, you shouldn't be afraid of sacrificing material. The idea is that although Black's got extra pieces and pawns, he's not doing anything with them. And you have got all your pieces in the game, you can attack his king quickly and effectively with the pieces you've developed and win the game straight away before he gets a chance to get any pieces out at all. And this is in fact what happens precisely in the next few moves of this game. Because Brown played bishop takes e5, which to a master is not very surprising, quite attractive to the beginner or average player, this type of sacrifice, but it's very, very logical. Because if we follow it through, it's the poor old black king that's coming under fire. And still the only piece that Black has managed to develop after 14 moves, and remember, this is a grandmaster, is his queen. Not a very satisfactory state of affairs. Well, Black's got to block the check. He brought his bishop out to e7, and now a crunchingly strong move by Brown. Rook to d5. Well, the idea of this, of course, is that if black takes on d5 with the queen, then the knight will go into c7, forking king and queen. Let me just show you that, because it's quite attractive. Queen takes the rook, and in goes the knight. A most unpleasant situation for black, whose queen, king and rook in the corner are all fought by the white knight. Well, all this was getting a bit too much for Señor Quinteros. He played queen to c8. And white then brought his knight to f5. Well, let's have a quick tally of the developed pieces. White's rook on d5 and his two knights are crunchingly poised to deliver the killing blow, a knight to d6. That would win the black queen. On top of that, white's queen, although it hasn't moved yet, is ready to come out to all manner of aggressive squares. It can come to f3, to g4, to a4, all manner of aggressive squares for the queen, and white threatens rook c1. Black is actually a clear piece up in this position, but none of his pieces are doing anything. Proof positive that an attack must be conducted speedily and effectively with all the developed pieces. Black hasn't developed any pieces. It's no surprise he can't do anything against the white attack. Well, king f8 was Quinteros' miserable move, but now white played very simply. Knight takes bishop. Slightly paradoxical there, but black cannot take with the knight because of the rook coming down to d8, which would be checkmate in two moves. Therefore, king takes e7, and now rook to e5 check, setting up the killer threat of queen to d6, which would finish black off on the very next move. Therefore, black resigned. Now, what can we learn from this game as I leave that final position up on the board for you to mull over? Well, I think the very first thing I'd like to say is it's important not to bring your queen out too early. This is very important. Lots of youngsters who are just starting out like to just play with their queen. It's the strongest piece and they want to get a feel for it. Well, that's good, that's fine, but don't use the queen too early, please, because all that will happen, as happened to Grandmaster Quinteros here, is that the queen will just get driven back and you'll lose time. And we can also learn, I think, from this game that it's very important to castle early and get the king to safety. I mean, the final position speaks volumes for that particular rule, doesn't it? Look at the white king nicely tucked away, perfectly safe behind its pawn cover. The black king out in the open. It's a fat lot of good that black has an extra piece in this position. None of his pieces ever got off the back rank. The graveyard is full of the bones of players who leave their king in the middle too long. So get castled is a very important rule in chess. You really do need a safe king. In this second game, we're going to see an international master falling into terrible difficulties because he makes too many pawn moves in the opening. He just lashes out with pawns, he doesn't develop any pieces for a while, and the opponent takes charge of the initiative. Don't make too many pawn moves in the opening. This is the lesson of the game you're about to see. Admittedly, the white player here, Nigel Povar, is a strong international master. And he does play a recognised variation thought to be very aggressive for white. But he comes unstuck against black's accurate and aggressive counterpunching. Let's see the opening. White plays c4 and black plays g6. White brings his knight out to c3 behind his pawns and black plays bishop g7. White plays pawn to e4 and black plays pawn to d6. And this is an opening, a very interesting opening, known as the King's Indian Defence. It's a provocative opening where black invites white to push all his pawns up and take the centre. And then at the right moment, black hopes to strike back against the white centre and blow it up to his advantage. It doesn't always work like that because strong players like to have the centre. But black's opening has found favour with many of the world champions and remains to this day one of the most aggressive and combative ways of playing against 1d4. Okay, here comes pawn to f4. the four pawns attack. And we quickly see that in the first five moves, white has actually made four of those moves with pawns. Now, the four pawn attack is not really a variation I can recommend to the average player. It's sophisticated and it requires very careful handling. Because what can happen really is that you fall so far behind in development making all these pawn moves that you end up getting attacked rather as Quinteros did in the last game, undeveloped, and you lose. So if you play like this, you have to have a very clear idea of where you're going. Just one little move by black, c5, white pushes on, and then black castles, and then we see that black is actually quite a long way ahead in development. So for white, his job is to develop his pieces now, catch up in development, and then hopefully attack in the centre using his advanced pawns. Black has got to try and disrupt white's plan by aggressive attack against the centre. And therefore Krupa, Pover's opponent, again an extremely strong player, played e6. And this is the way that black attacks the centre. As you can see, black is attacking the pawn on d5 with the pawn on e6, making life difficult for white. White would like to advance those pawns and blow black away, but black is making it difficult for him with this little pawn move. Now comes a very surprising idea, and one which leads white into a spot of bother. He played e5, and this is really going for glory. Now, counting the moves up, we've had 8 moves, and so far 6 of these moves from white have been with pawns. It's not really logical for white to expect that he's going to blow a very strong player away using these tactics. Why? Because black hasn't done anything wrong. Black's castled, he's developed his pieces sensibly, and he's attacking the white centre. So, as he's done nothing wrong, there's no real reason for white to expect anything other than difficulties playing in this manner. On with the game. Black took on e5. F takes e5, and now knight to g4. And already white starts to feel the heat against his advanced centre. As you can see, the knight on g4 and the bishop on g7 double up to attack the pawn on e5. So white's got to worry about that pawn right away. Black's always got the move e takes d5, also marked on the diagram, in hand, which would open up prospects for the bishop on c8. So I would say that black's already in very good shape here. His king, particularly his king, is safe. White's king, as you can see, stuck in the middle, is yet to castle. I consider this position to be perfectly satisfactory for black because of his superior development. Right, on with the show. White's got to do something about the attack. He played his bishop out to g5. We call this a counter-attack. Now, very often the best method of attack is to counter-attack, putting the opponent on his mettle. But here I think it's possible that bishop f4 was better, just defending the pawn in the centre. Because after bishop g5, black gets the opportunity to play another aggressive move. And now, well, the heat really is on white. White's precise problem is not that he's going to lose a central pawn. He needn't do that. He can protect his pawns. But white's main problem, as I say, is his king stuck in the middle there. That is not a very pleasant place for the king to be. That king would much rather be on g1 in this particular position. And as you can see, the queen on a5 pins the knight on c3 against the king. So white's got a few problems to solve in this position. Well, all thanks to the fact that he's been moving too many pawns. Pover elected to sacrifice his e-pawn. He played bishop e2. And that's the type of sacrifice which white can expect to have to make in this particular line. By and large, he's not too unhappy if black takes his e-pawn, because that would allow him the chance of an attack on the f-file. White's main priority at this stage is just to get his king to safety. It's as simple as that. And for that reason, Krupa played very logically. He took on d5, opening up the bishop on c8. White played c takes d5. And now c4. A very interesting move. And And I've highlighted what I think is Black's plan in this position. In fact, Black has the very cunning idea of moving his queen across to c5 with the idea of plonking the queen down on f2, which looks almost like a very basic checkmate. But that threat, coupled with the idea of the knight, Black's knight on g4 going into f2, is very strong indeed. And White really has to consider giving up material in this position, probably in exchange if Black wants to take it, in order to just survive the opening. So strong is Black's threat of queen c5 in this position. So please note the move c4, freeing up the c5 square for the queen. Very strong move. Povar castled. Black played h6. And White went bishop to e7. Well, for the moment, White has stopped Black's threat of queen to c5 check. And it seems as though the bishop on e7 is rather well placed, because it also attacks the rook on f8. But after the simple rook to e8, there's no reason for Black to give up any material whatsoever. White now has a bit of a problem. If he moves his bishop, he loses the pawn on e5. And if he protects the bishop, as he did with d6, he leaves himself open once again to Black's crushing threat of queen to b6 or c5 check, maybe followed by knight f2 or knight e3. Well, already Black has many good moves. He could check, as I indicated, on b6 or c5. He could bring his knight to e3 straight away. That would win material. The queen would have to move, and Black, if he wished, could take the rook off on f1. But it's very instructive now to see how these strong players play, because Krupa rejected all those moves, which were all quite good, quite decent moves, in favour of bishop to e6. Now that really is a masterly move, in my opinion, because Krupa actually recognises that it's very difficult. White's got so many problems in this position, he can't solve all his problems at once. He's got a problem with a bishop on e7. Is that bishop really in play or is it out of play? He's got a problem with a pawn on e5. And Krupa has actually realised that, well, the main problem for White is that pawn, the black pawn on c4, which is actually stopping White from doing lots of different things. So top priority was to play a piece out to protect that pawn. And that's precisely what Black did, showing fantastic judgment, in my opinion. And really putting the pressure on White. White is still suffering from his rather over-aggressive opening play, where he lashed all his pawns up the board. Well, knight d4 was the miserable reply. Povar's hoping to be able to take that bishop off the board. But now comes the rub. Queen takes e5. That pawn's been threatened for many moves. And now the queen comes to take the pawn off. And Black has numerous threats. In fact, Black is now threatening checkmate on h2. The queen will be threatening to come down to h2. He's threatening the knight on d4 as well. And so for that reason, White's next move is forced. He must play knight f3. Then comes the check. And we see that rather than the four pawns attack, which is what White intended, the pawn centre has disappeared completely. And only one pawn remains, which really blocks in the services of the bishop on e7. So White's opening has been a complete disaster. King went to h1, only move. And now again, fantastic judgment by Krupa. Many, many players here would just play their knight into f2. But Krupa plays knight c6. Just leaving White with all his problems. There's really nothing for White in this position. He can't deal with all Black's threats. Black prefers development to grabbing material, even at this stage of the game. Well, knight e4, this is desperate stuff. Queen went to d5. Again, that leaves White with numerous problems. The bishop on e7 is attacked. The knight on e4 is attacked. Queens came off. This didn't really help very much. White protected his knight. And the final move of the game, was knight e3. And just to show you how many threats black is actually amassing in this position, I've highlighted all the threats on the diagram. The first threat is that black's knight will take off the bishop on e7. Then black's got a big bishop on g7, zooming down to take the pawn off on b2. The knight on e3 threatens the rook on f1, and white's knights are very uncomfortably situated, protecting one another in the middle of the board. So for that reason, Povar decided to resign. Well, the main idea of that example was to show you that it's important not to make too many pawn moves in the opening. Make only the pawn moves that are necessary to ensure a smooth and effective development of your pieces. Povar fell behind in development, the other guy got his pieces out, and he got crushed. You don't really want to get attacked and crushed in the opening. Don't make too many pawn moves, get your pieces out. Planning's just as important in the opening of the game as in any other stage of the game, in the middle game, end game. You've got to try and play with a plan, and this is the theme of the game you're about to see. Take a look now at this next little attacking masterpiece. A game, an old game, between Andras Lilienthal, Russian grandmaster, veteran, against a guy called Hamming. And this game was played in Zandvoort, 1934. It really is a gem. And it illustrates the important point that you should try and control, occupy and dominate the centre of the board in the opening, if at all possible. Also try to play with a plan. You'll see very quickly that whilst white is playing with a very clear plan in mind in this game, black really doesn't understand the position and flounders around until it's too late. Well, the opening was straightforward. It's an opening known as the Queen's Gambit. White plays d4, black d5, and c4 by white. There are many moves for black here. Hamming chose the declined version of the Queen's Gambit, 2e6. And white played the standard move, knight out to c3. So white is trying to create pressure against the d5 square. That's the basic idea in the Queen's Gambit. And what black should be doing really is to reinforce the d5 point. That is his main defensive plan in the opening. But I don't really like black's next move. What he does is kind of a halfway house between variations. He plays d takes c4. That's not a very good move in my opinion. It seems to be a change of mind, a change of tack. Black started off defending himself with e6, and now he changes his mind. He snaps off a white pawn. Well, Lilienthal didn't need a second invitation. He occupied the centre, e4. And this is a very strong move. As you can see, the two white central pawns, those are ideal positions for the pawns in the opening. Whether you're white or black, that's the sort of thing you should be trying to aim for, because as you can see, the two pawns abreast control four key central squares. They stop the black pieces from coming out to those squares, which is the main crucial point. And on top of that, as a bonus, white is threatening bishop takes c4, which would develop his bishop, regain the pawn, and avoid any loss of time. So a terrific game for white already, thanks to this small inaccuracy by black, d takes c4. It's amazing how one little move, and it's, let's face it, a move that anybody could make, could change the position so radically. Well, black decided to try and get onto the attack himself. He played c5. But it's already slightly too late, because white is in a very good position to dominate the central area of the board here with the advance d5. An aggressive move, striking at the heart of black's position, establishing a pawn in black's half of the board. And at any stage, white is threatening to go bishop takes c4, which would just regain the pawn. I don't think it's possible for black to keep the pawn here. What he should be thinking about doing is trying to get an equal game here, possibly by developing some pieces. As you can see, black hasn't even developed a single piece in this position. a6. A continuation of the same high-risk strategy. This type of thing can't work. For beginners, it's hopeless, because they don't learn anything. They don't develop their pieces. You've got to get the feeling that you're developing your pieces. Your pieces are actually doing something for you. What is black actually doing when he plays a6? Okay, he's threatening maybe b5, protecting his pawn. Well, Lilienthal wasn't worried by that in the slightest. He just plays a4, putting black back on move, and then black still got the same problems. On top of that, the a6 move doesn't appear to be doing black's position a lot of good in this position. I mean, what use is that move to him? Having played knight f6, bishop takes c4, and now it was high time that black took on d5, whatever the consequences of that move. I'm not sure how to evaluate exactly the position if black took on d5 here, but let's say it's at least a bit better for white. I would much prefer to be white. Better development, a presence in the enemy half of the board. Why not? Much better for white. But the move Hamming made was indicative of his poor frame of mind on that day, because he played e5. And that really is the move of a coward. It's the move of a player who really is very unsure where he's going in the game. Again, black doesn't develop any pieces. He's trying to block the game up. He's trying to stop white from attacking him, but it's a case of out of the frying pan, into the fire. Too many pawn moves equal disaster. f4, a crunching attack. And now black really does have problems. I would say he is seriously worse in this position. If black takes on f4, he gets the move e4, e5 straight away, which disrupts his position completely. Hamming tried to bolster up his position with bishop d6, but after knight f3, simple developing move after all, he's got the same problem. As you can see, the knight on f3 and the pawn on f4 are targeting the black pawn on e5. And now black has to play knight bd7. That's a very unnatural move. In general, let's say you want to assess the position in the opening. You look at the position and you think, how do I assess this? Who is better? Well, take a look at black's last move. Hasn't that blocked in one of his pieces? A key bishop on c8? Wouldn't that bishop rather be in the game? And then take a look at white's position. Which of white's pieces is blocked in? None of them. So if you want to try and assess a position, try and assess it on those terms. Have a look around. If none of your pieces is blocked in and you're opponent's actually got blocked in pieces, likely you've got a big advantage in the position. And so it proves here, because the blockage means that black is going to have to waste time. It costs him a lot of time and energy just getting his pieces out, whereas white can spend the time profitably playing natural moves like castles and getting onto the attack, maybe on the f-file, as you can see. Well, black castled too. Couldn't do any better than that. And now a very strong move by white. Take a little time out before we play on here to see if you could forecast white's next move. Well, did you find the move f5? That's a very strong move. Several ideas come to mind. The first idea really is now the bishop on c1 is free. When it comes out to g5, it puts the knight on f6 in a very uncomfortable pin. White's queen, as you can see, has a natural route now to come and join in the party on the king side. Queen e1, and then maybe queen out to h4 and to g3. And it's about here that Lilienthal was probably constructing the winning plan in his mind. Having established a pawn on f5, he now wants to attack the black king with all guns blazing, bringing everything into the attack. And, well, seeing as black's pieces are all blocked in, there's very little the black can do about it. And so it proves. Queen c7 was a desperate attempt to get out of any pin, but it didn't prevent white from putting his bishop on g5 anyway. That is a good move. Black tried to bail out through tactics with knight b6, but then came a very strong move indeed by white, bishop takes f6. Now obviously if black's got to play g takes f6 here, it's a complete disaster for him, because that would ruin his king position without any compensation. But Hamming's bright idea was to take the bishop on c4. Of course he didn't see the next move, which was knight to g5. Oh, beautiful move. With several threats. I've highlighted the main threat. The not so subtle idea of bringing the queen to h5 and then into h7 with checkmate, backed up by the knight. But what happens, you might ask, if black took on f6? Well, now the depth of Lilienthal's idea is revealed as we play through the following very attractive variation. Knight takes h7 was his idea. If black then played knight to e3, the queen would come out to h5, increasing the number of pieces in the danger area around the black king. Black's only got one move now, king g7, and then rook to f3. This was the basic idea. And the poor old black king is now being attacked by rook, queen and knight, and hardly has any defensive pieces to help it whatsoever. So it's hardly surprising that after black's best moves, as here, it's very difficult for black to defend himself. Knight g5, the queen's coming down, rook goes to h8, and then a beautiful move, knight to e6 check. That was the idea behind Lilienthal's brilliant combination. And the white queen will penetrate decisively to g6 with checkmate in the offing. I think you'll find that that's a very beautiful idea. So back now with knight g5, and black played the miserable move h6. Probably couldn't see anything better. But now in came the queen. When you're attacking, the logic is you attack with everything. Bring the kitchen sink in if you can. Rook e8. Bishop takes g7. Look at the pieces surrounding the black king. Bishop, knight, queen. What's defending? Nothing. King takes g7. And the concluding move was f6 check. White's queen is on a very fast track to the g7 square. And there's absolutely nothing that black can do about it. So that's an interesting game for you. A very aggressive performance by Lilienthal. But the sad truth of the matter is there was one guy there playing with a plan, one guy who was occupying, dominating the centre, another guy who really didn't have any clue what he was doing at all and paid the full price. In the final part of this video, we're going to look at a couple of games from Master Chess where the winner brings all his pieces together against the loser. This is a very important concept, the idea of using all your pieces as a unit, working together, and it's one you've got to take on board. Let's take a look at these two games right now. It's very important that you try and make your pieces work together for you in chess. That's the way to get the best possible position out of the opening. I'm going to illustrate this point by showing you a short game between Paul Littlewood and Jonathan Penrose. And this comes from the 1979 British Championship. It's a game where black seems to coordinate his pieces very quickly and very early on, and this confuses white and leads to his fatal mistake. Let's see this game. White plays d4 and black plays d5, c4, d takes c4. This is the queen's gambit accepted. It might seem a very risky approach by black because he's actually allowing white to dominate the centre. But black has some accurate ideas in mind to deflect this dominance. The first of these is a6. Well, now white's got to worry about whether black is actually threatening to go b5, protecting his pawn on c4. Littlewood invited that, but Penrose wasn't having any of it, playing knight f6. This shows the approach of the stronger player. He much prefers to develop his pieces rather than to protect or grab hot pawns in the opening. Although white gets his pawn back, black establishes a very effective development by just playing c5 here. Okay, white played a4. This is all very standard stuff. And both sides continue to develop their pieces. The knight comes out to c6. White plays queen e2. And now queen to c7. And here's the first sign that black intends to coordinate his pieces against the white king. In particular, against the h2 square. Now, the queen, the black queen, is actually placed on a very effective diagonal, which I've highlighted for you, all the way down to h2. And if he can back it up, with possibly the bishop coming out to d6, and maybe even the knight to g4, then if white isn't careful, his king might come under fire. It's amazing how quickly and how easily black's plan comes to fruition in this particular game. But for the moment, white continues to play good moves. He played knight c3. That must be a good move, developing the knight. Sure enough, black played bishop d6, and he's bringing his pieces together, really. Now the bishop and the queen are working effectively against the h2 square. And white played king h1. And that's a slightly peculiar move by white. It's a kind of admission that black is actually coming up with a decent plan here. And white really can't see what to do, so he just plays his king into the corner, getting out of any tricks. Or so he thinks. Well, black castled. Another strong move. White played d takes c5. Bishop takes c5. And now pawn up to e4. So, for the moment, Littlewood is playing well. The only move I would really query is king h1. I mean, I'm not sure I really see the relevance of that move in this particular position. But it's fair to say that white's position is perfectly okay. But now, knight to g4. A very strong move indeed. And I've highlighted the areas of the board which I think white's got to seriously think about here. You'll note the knight on g4 is now actually threatening two things. It's threatening the pawn on h2, combining with the queen on c7, and it's threatening the pawn on f2, combining with the bishop on c5. So black is actually using his pieces together to work for him against white's weak points. If white kept his cool in this position and played g3, then he'd still be all right. It wouldn't be too friendly to have that pawn weakness around his king and the weak white squares, but he could still perhaps survive the black attack. What he does, faced with all this pressure, is disastrous. He played bishop a2, allowing knight d4, overloading the poor old knight on f3. The knight on f3 cannot protect the pawn on h2 and at the same time protect his queen indirectly on e2. So in fact, this knight d4 move wins the game, overloading the knight on f3, finishing the game straight away. White resigned. So a very bright and breezy example of how important it is to coordinate your pieces and get all your pieces working for you in the opening, particularly against the enemy soft spots, if you can. Take a look around you at other junior games. What do you notice? Chances are you'll see a lot of players who try to attack very early on in the game. Quite often without any justification whatsoever. They're attacking prematurely, before the time is right really to do so. And actually this trait, this problem occurs quite often in top class chess. People attack without any base at all for their attack, and they're doomed against very strong play, very strong countermeasures. I'm going to show you a game here by the great Bobby Fischer, and he's playing an opponent who he had real problems with early on in his career, Arthur Bisguier. But here he doesn't have any problems at all beating back Bisguier's premature attack. He does it using a combination of quick development and accurate countermeasures. Let's see this entertaining game. The opening was one of the most famous chess openings of all, the Ruy López, or Spanish opening, as it's often known these days. And it's introduced with white's third move, bishop to b5. Not so much threatening to take a pawn, bishop takes c6 and knight takes e5, more just threatening to castle and content with the steady, slow build-up of pressure on black's position. The Ruy López is an opening of sustained pressure, but white takes quite a bit of time and patience to build up before he actually tries to attack black directly. I wish the same could be said for Bisguier in this game, because he goes straight for the jugular with bishop to b7. This is the Archangel variation. And it's a line where black tries to put pressure on white's centre, notably the pawn on e4 here. Well, Fischer played d4, doubtless encouraging black to sound the charge, and Bisguier needed no further invitation. Knight takes d4. Knight takes knight, pawn takes knight, c3, and now a very risky move by black. Knight takes e4. I would definitely counsel against this type of pawn grabbing in the opening. For starters, after Fischer's next move, rook e1, the knight is pinned. And secondly, black is banking all his hopes on the move bishop d6 here, which is essentially an attempt to get out of this mess using tactics. It doesn't really work, unfortunately. Fischer continues with sensible development. He played knight to d2, really accelerating the pressure on e4. And black now played his idea, bishop takes h2. The point of this is that if white now plays king takes h2, black will play queen h4 check, king g1, queen takes f2 check, and have at least a draw. Probably no more, because the knight is still pinned and black's only working with the queen, but black does have a draw by perpetual check if he wants it in this position. Fischer's not interested with that sort of result, and he plays king f1. And now in the rest of this game, we're treated to a very fine demonstration by white of how to coordinate your pieces and make them all work together for you against a premature attack. Well, already black's got problems in this position. He's got to protect his knight somehow, and he came out with d5. But after queen h5, we can see that suddenly white has created multiple threats. Firstly, most importantly, and most directly, of course, he's threatening to go backwards with his queen to take off the bishop on h2. He's also threatening rook takes e4, which is pretty crushing, because black wouldn't able to recapture that rook. The queen would just come down to f7 and give checkmate. So Bisguier doubtless thought he had it all under control when he elected to sacrifice a piece. He played castles, and the idea was that after queen takes bishop on h2, he would play d takes c3, knight takes e4, d takes e4, b takes c3, c5, and in this position black would have three pawns for the piece, and hopefully enough compensation in terms of those pawns to claim that he had a good game. Well, unfortunately, this position is massively better for white, and Fischer shows why. In an endgame, black's pawns might be dangerous, but white's job here is to stay in the middle game and launch an attack with his superior firepower, the extra piece, and this is precisely what Fischer does. He kicks off with rook e3, and this is a very strong move. Fischer's actually bringing his pieces together to try and coordinate them for an attack against h7. As you can see, the rook might be threatening to come across to h3, and in combination with the queen, to zoom down to h7, and that would be lethal. I think black's main problem here, the bishop on b7, as you can see, is blocked in by the pawn on e4. If that pawn, the black pawn on e4, were on a black square, then there's some argument for saying that black's okay. But here, with the pawn blocking in the bishop on b7, it's a question of mobility, really. The bishop on b7 isn't very good, whereas all of white's pieces are ready to come into the attack, well, more or less immediately. Well, black played c4. That's another pawn on a light square, making his bishop even worse. But I guess black felt he had to drive white's bishop off that diagonal. And the queen came out to f6. Rook came across to h3, as we expected. And now queen f5. Now, a very, very strong move again by Fischer. Bishop to e3. And this is an object lesson, really, in how to get the pieces onto their best squares. Incidentally, in case you were wondering what this has got to do with the opening, it's not really clear to me that the opening hasn't finished yet. I mean, in the opening, Black sacrificed a piece for three pawns. That was his idea. He's trying to justify that sacrifice now. And I guess we're virtually at the end of the opening now. And we can claim that White has a pretty big advantage here. The bishop, as you can see on e3, is going to d4. There's pressure against the black king from bishop, rook and queen. And black has no real counterplay at all, because after rook a d8, that's probably the best move, rook e1, rook d7, bishop d4. That's a picture postcard from White's point of view. All of his pieces are in action. None of Black's pieces seem to be doing very much. And it's a simple question of whether White can actually consummate his attack against the black king either now or in the very near future. Well, rook e8 was the only move. Rook h5. Pawn to g5. Horrible move to have to make. g4. Queen g6. And now rook to h6. And that is the end of the game for the poor old queen. A disastrous opening experiment by Bisguier, but really, a premature attack of this kind is doomed to failure against, well, such a strong player as Fischer. But virtually against any master, it will be easy to refute this type of over-aggressive play. I've got nearly 2,000 chess books in my chess library, and over half of them are devoted to the problems of the opening. All the ins and outs, all the do's and don'ts. Yet now you've mastered the important information on this video, the general principles of the opening, you're ready to sit down and play with anybody. And if you don't believe me, go out there and try it.